and welcome back to Book Stage and Screen. We are absolutely thrilled to have Delwyn Jenkins here and Lisa Ireland. And now you're only part of a team this week that we came in to talk about, part of the Heroes and Happy Endings.
Yeah, we have, there's four of us on Sunday, what is it, 3 o'clock, I think? Yeah. 3 o'clock at Warm Ponds Library in up in Geelong. Delwyn and I belong to a group of published authors, mainly romance authors, and got a couple of women's fiction authors in that group too. I think there's about 10 of us in the group, and so we get together and have a bit of lunch and coffee and stuff from time to time. And so four of us are doing a little panel which is called Heroes and Happy Endings on Sunday. Yeah.
With Nikki Edwards and Alex Sinclair.
Yes, with Nikki Edwards and Alex Sinclair. Sorry.
Yeah, but we don't. We only have two mics, so we...
We're practically full house at the moment with you two. So
beautiful. Yeah. And that's what we will remind listeners about that at the end, but that we just... I saw that online. I thought, oh, I know these lovely ladies, so I'm going to grab them in and talk about that. And so what do you hope to talk about on that, on that panel?
The four of us write... still within the romance umbrella, but we write quite divergent stories.
Yeah.
So on one end, one of the girls writes very sweet stories. I'm at the complete other end, and the other girl sits somewhere in the middle.
Okay.
So there's pretty much something for everybody.
Yes.
And that's one of the things with the four of us, because we're so diverse, we're hoping to get quite a broad audience. So people who might not necessarily read what I write will have something with Lisa or with Ali or with Nikki. So but really anyone who's interested in books, because authors, whether they're in your genre or not, authors are always interesting to talk to, listen to, because you always pick up something. Oh, I didn't know that, or I wonder if that goes across the board. Or so we're hoping to get, truly anyone who's interested is more than welcome.
And now for you, Delwyn, you write in two different, not genres, but two different ways and under two different names. Yeah. So that's really interesting. Tell us a bit about that.
I wrote a series, because I tend to read erotic romance, so my benchmark for what's spicy is not the same as everybody else's. So I wrote what I thought was a mainstream kind of book.
Yeah.
And so I thought I'd publish those under my real name and then the erotic fiction under a pseudonym to protect the innocent, really.
Yeah.
And then when I sold them, what I considered mainstream book, and my publisher said, oh, we'll put this under erotic romance. And I went, what, are you sure? And he went, yeah. Oh, really? So it was a bit, so the ones that are erotic romance are full on.
Yeah.
But the other ones are, the sex scenes in them aren't all that frequent, but the language and description is explicit. So that's really, it's always for me about people who love each other.
Yeah.
So it's always, the sex scenes are always about the relationship.
Yeah.
And they're always about mutual respect and love, and it's always part of the story.
Yeah.
It's just that it's quite explicit in description and language. So if that's not your bag, you can either skip over it or buy someone else's books.
Yeah. And that's someone being your other.
Yeah.
Your other
guy.
Yes,
queen. Yep.
So, and do you have different publishers for the different stories?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So my... my Delwyn Jenkins books are published by Momentum, which is a digital imprint for Pan Macmillan.
Yeah, great.
And my erotic romance stories are published by Allura's Cave, which is an American company.
Oh, okay. Mm. So how did you find an American publisher? Did you seek them out knowing that? Right.
Yeah, I chose them. Mm-hmm. Not much different, because everything's electronic.
Right.
Like everything's electronic. I found because they're a smaller company and they're mainly digital, there's some differences, but really, you just email. I found, though, with Momentum, with my Delwyn Jenkins books, I can pretty much send them an email, and in the header just put Delwyn, because I know who I am.
Right.
Whereas when I send to Laura's Cave, I have to go Delwyn Jenkins writing as DJ Michaels, blah, 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 blah.
Oh, right.
Because I'm one of a gajillion. Whereas, so I actually really liked writing for Momentum and belonging to Pan Mac. I really enjoyed that experience. So, but, the publishing's a big world. Every publisher's different, and it's all part of the learning process as you go along.
Yes.
You just have some things you just have to suck up, princess, and other things. Oh, fantastic, I'll be coming back to them.
So what tips would you give to people that want to write in different genres, simultaneously, I guess?
Well, funny we should mention that, because I'm about to try to undergo the process of amalgamating my names. Writing under two names has proven a little bit too unwieldy.
Right.
With two websites, two Facebook pages, it's just too much.
Yeah.
but I've also noticed there's quite a few writers that I really admire who are very successful who write multi subgenres. So they write in paranormal.
Shakespeare, perhaps.
Well, I do actually really admire him. But they write in, you know, paranormal. They write contemporary. They write, and they all do it under the one name. So that's
like
what I'll
Sylvia
do.
Sylvia Day.
Yeah, Sylvia Day's a classic example. Okay. I love her books.
Yeah,
and she writes cross genre. So I'm.
And what's good in her case is that she'll get some crossover readers. So some readers might really love her. I don't know what sort of stuff.
Crossfire series.
Yeah. So some people might love that and then come along to a completely different type of genre that she's writing.
Yeah.
I mean, other people might just stick with the one thing. Mm. But what you're finding is with the two names that you're losing your readers and they get confused.
I'm not getting enough cross pollination because these days I have it on my website, but readers don't go to website these days.
Yeah.
They're on your Facebook page. Unless you're bleeding about it every 5 minutes, I don't know. So I'm losing a lot of that cross pollination that Lisa's talking about. Yeah, because Lisa's flipping into a new genre.
Yeah. Yes. So Lisa, you write at the moment.
I write rural romance, which has been a really popular sort of genre, and I accidentally got into it because I was actually aiming at Harlequin Mills and Boone many, many years ago, about 10 years ago, and I wrote a book that was not accepted by them, but they asked me, I sent it off, I sent them a partial and they said, oh yes, we like it, send us a full, and then they told me all the things that were wrong with it, and mainly it was set in Australia, and so they didn't like that, and it had too many characters on it, so I threw it in a drawer, and then about probably 7 or 8 years later I read a book by Rachel Johns called Jilted, and I know Rachel, so I bought the book and I'm reading it, I went, I've got a book like this, and it's, you know, it was a single title, popular romance. So I got out my thing out of the drawer and fixed it up and sent it off to Escape, which is the digital arm of Harlequin Australia, and it got picked up. And then so from there I went on to write more rural romances, which I really love. It's great. The readers are fantastic. They're really loyal and very popular. People love to read about the Australian experience, but my real love in reading is women's fiction. I love, you know, Leanne Moriarty. Jane Green and Jennifer Weiner and all those types of books. And so last year I was writing a new rural and I just couldn't make it work. I was just sitting, I'd sit down to write every day, and I'm one of those people that likes to have written. I don't necessarily enjoy the writing process. I find it a bit arduous, but I usually don't mind first draft. Once I get into it, I'm kind of, the first few chapters are a bit tricky, but once I get into the draft, I'm off and running. But every day I would sit down and I'd go, you know, it was like wading through mud.
Yeah.
And another writing friend said, have you got any other ideas? Have you got something else? Why don't you break it up and write something else? And I said, oh, I've got that women's fiction idea, but I don't know. And she said, why don't you just try it? Just plonk that down on the page and just write a few things down until you get stuck. And so I started writing, and 120,000 words later, I was still was finished and I hadn't got stuck yet.
Wow.
So that book's just been sold, but I can't give you any other details other than that because it's going to have a title change.
Yep.
But that'll be out next year. So, but I'm still hoping to keep writing the rurals as well.
Can you tell us the genre of this?
Yeah, this one's just just contemporary commercial women's fiction.
Oh, okay.
So similar to, I know you had Tess Woods on before, so similar, same sort of genre as that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, as Tess's book, yeah.
Yeah. And can you tell us the publisher or the
I'm not going to talk about that just yet. I'm going to make an announcement really soon.
Sorry,
I would love to tell you today,
so
but
just
not.
Basically, we just want to know your tax return details and that's and we're happy. So how many books all up have we got written between you two? What's the total?
I've got 7.
And 4 finished, so yeah.
So we're in double figures.
Yeah.
Well done, ladies.
Yeah.
Well done.
Yeah, that's amazing. And, well, I was just reading the other day, somewhere, I'm on social media way too much, that about romance, and I mean, there's so many sub-genres in it, and publishers and arms, I guess, of it, but it is the biggest selling genre in Australia.
It's pretty much the rough kind of gauge is 50%, says 50% of sales. It outsells every other genre fiction combined.
That's amazing.
And it's like a $42 billion industry, and because without getting on my soapbox, but I'm going to cry. Because it's primarily written by women for women, it tends to be shunted to the side and dismissed and disvalued, when in fact, you know, or people say, oh, you write that fluff. You know, it's entertainment. I'm not out to change the world. I don't think I've got the answer to the universe.
Yeah.
I just would like people to read my stories and enjoy them. And I know a lot of other authors who get letters from women, often women, going, you know, I've been in hospital with my mum. She's dying of cancer, and your book was the only thing that kept me sane. Mm. Like, that is not fluff.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And I always say to people when they go, oh, you write that romance stuff, and they screw their nose up, what we write about is relationships.
Yeah.
And there's nobody who doesn't want to be in one, or wish they weren't in one, or want to be in somebody else's, or never, like, really, because most human beings are built for relationships, so that's what we write about.
Yeah.
And the fact that it gets poo-pooed and drives me crackers.
Yeah, I don't think, well, I mean, honestly, in the end, the figures speak for themselves, isn't it? I mean, if it was a piece of fluff up, it would just be a sort of a trend that would die out, but it's been there. And I went to the RWA conference in Melbourne last year, and it was my first ever, and I was 400 people.
You may have to define what RWA is.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, the secret club.
Not telling.
Yeah, with a handshake.
I know, and you don't.
I might have forgotten. It's the Romance Writers Association.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And, you know, it was a new world to me in terms of, it's been, that conference has been going for...
Well, this is my, I think this year will... I've been in RWA for 11 years, and it's actually our 25th.
This is our 25th.
Oh, okay.
In Adelaide. Yeah, in Adelaide.
It looks like it's going to be huge in Adelaide.
Yes.
I mean, Melbourne last year. I can't go. But we're trying to get one of the speakers there, Michael Haig, who's doing that story. We're hopefully getting him on here.
Oh, spoiler alert, the upcoming show.
Because I'd been writing, you know, because I went to university as an adult.
Yeah.
And then I rolled into the professional writing and editing course at the Gordon, and that's when I really started writing. But I kind of went for 10 years in the wilderness on my own,
right,
thinking I was writing and really wasn't. And then I was talking to someone, they said, join RWA, get a critique partner, and from there, that association is pretty much the reason I'm published.
Right.
They taught me how to write properly. They put me in, like, my book sold because I had a pitch, which means I sit in front of an editor and I've got 5 minutes to say, hi, I'm Delwyn, this is my book, blah, blah, blah. And he goes, yeah, that sounds good, send me the first three chapters. So I sold my book on a pitch.
Yeah.
So it just makes sure that you're not in a slush pile, that actually when your book comes in, they actually do read it, because sometimes that doesn't happen. Mm. So, but it's all the craft stuff and the support of other writers, because it sometimes can be a lonely business.
It's an extremely professional organisation. Yes. I think people who come from outside, because we often have journalists come to have a bit of a squeeze, or I've got lots of friends that write in other genres, people who write in, you know, maybe crime or fantasy, which might have some romance crossover. Mm. And I'll often say to them, you really should come to our conference or join the organisation. Mm. It's, you know, worth your while. And I think they kind of think, oh, romance. So, yeah, I don't write romance. But when they come and have a look and have a listen to the speakers, because good writing is good writing. Yes, it doesn't matter what genre you're writing.
Exactly.
We're all doing the same thing. So, as you just pointed out, we've got Michael Haig coming this year. And some of the fantastic speakers I've seen have been unlikely too. Like, there's a romance writer called Debbie Maycomba, who is this, she's an American woman, and she's extremely successful. She's multiple New York Times bestseller list. But I'd never heard of her. She came along and she got up and told this story about herself as a child. And she's actually dyslexic. Mm-hmm. And she's gone on through, there's RWA America. And so she'd gone along to that and learned her craft and persisted. And she said, you know, she tells this really funny story about how when she first started out, she was sending off and the rejection, she said, I'd go and put it in the post office box and get hit on the head on my way back home with the rejection letter, you know, she said. But she persisted and persisted and continued to hone her craft through RWA. And now she's a multi-award winning and best-selling author. So, you know, sometimes those stories are really inspirational, aren't they?
The very first RWA conference I went to was in 2011, and I knew nothing about nothing.
Yeah.
And not a lot's changed, I know. And at the awards, now they have this thing called a stand-up, and Anne Gracie, who's a very well-respected author, gets at the front, and she says, you know, stand up if you're a New York Times best-selling author. And in that room of 300-odd women, there was about eight of them that stood up.
Wow.
And I nearly had a heart attack because knew nothing about nothing. Mm-hmm. But, you know, if that had been Bryce Courtney or Tim Winton, mm-hmm. they would be household names. But mm-hmm. because of our genre, you know, and I thought, like, being in the same room as a New York Times bestselling author, or the fact that you can just go up to one and have a chat, they're mm-hmm. delightful women.
Yeah.
And the other thing I found about RWA is the all-embracing
absolutely.
The sisterhood. Yeah. They're very, people are very happy to answer questions or help you along or yeah. suggest things for you or even just to sit down and have a chat about your dogs. Like, yeah. you yeah. know, they're mm-hmm. they're really, well, not all of them, because in any group there's, you know, people who aren't as nice as they could be. Yeah.
But it is
on the whole, yeah, mm-hmm. very embracing.
It's a very embracing. To write romance, you find yourself amongst, like, a sisterhood. I mean, there yes. are blokes that write. We do mm. have a few. But mm. It's mainly women. And as Delwyn said, I found the same thing. Was from the very first, my introduction was at a conference, so I was mm. probably like you, went along yeah. to one. And I was a bit reluctant. I was studying professional writing and editing at, I think it was Homesland TAFE then, there was a, but at Blackwood Street in Yarraville with Cheryl yep. Clark, who's a well-known Western Suburbs writer. Hi, yep. Cheryl, if you're listening. Anyway, she was teaching me, and we had to, as part of that course, go off to either a writer's festival or a conference or something, mm. and I was dragged along by one of the other class members, quite reluctantly, I have to say, because I didn't really know anything much about romance.
Yeah.
But the big draw card was that there was, I can't remember who it was now, but there was a really well-known international speaker who I'll think of later.
As soon as you're off air, it'll come
as
to you.
As soon as, yeah.
the moment.
And so I thought, oh, well, it would be all right just for that. But
yeah.
in the end, that was probably the least exciting. Mm. He was good, but I think that was obviously the least memorable thing about that whole conference. The most memorable thing was just all these women helping each other. And it's exactly the same experience as Del when I think I met Anne Gracie at that particular conference too, but also another author called Barbara Hannah, who I've still got such a girl crush on. And I honestly embarrass her every time I see her because I, you know, I always wax lyrical about how much I love her and how much I love her books. And she made me cry at the ARA. ARA is the Australian Romance Readers Association, which is another really yeah. fantastic organisation to belong to. But they have a conference every 2 years, and I was in Canberra. We were both in Canberra. Last year. And I was on a panel, and at the end of the panel, Barbara Hannay, who is my absolute, like, hero, came up to me and said, oh, you did a great job, Lisa. That was very interesting and, you know, good on you. I nearly fainted. And I was sort of frothing at the mouth saying, oh, thank you. So it's a very embracing, warm sort of, it's a great place to, a great occupation, because you feel like you're in the great embrace of all these, you know, other lovely women who we feel like we're, you know, working and having fun with our friends.
Yeah. Because I read an article about RWA America, and we're modelled on the same thing, and the journalist said, you know, it's the only place I've been to where people train their competitors.
Yes,
because
we do.
Because
it's true.
In that environment, people are very forthcoming, and experienced authors run workshops, or if they have an area of expertise, they run a workshop, and you can go along and make notes and learn things. So it's a quite unique situation.
I'm mindful of paying it forward. Yes. Like, we've been helped by by people who've gone before us, and we want to do the same things for other writers coming along. So one of the speakers on Sunday, Nikki Edwards, is a newer author, but she's wildly successful. Mm. She's prolific.
With you.
Oh, yes.
It was her first conference last year as well.
Okay. Yeah. So she's joined our published authors group in Geelong, and we were at her book launch recently, and she sort of said, oh, you know, thank you so much to all the RWA members who are here and at my little Geelong group who've pretty much taught me everything I know. So, and then she'll pay it forward to somebody else. So,
yeah. Yes. Oh, yeah, it was fantastic. And also the broad range when I got the the syllabus, the conference,
program.
Yeah, the program. and I saw it, I'm like this, oh my God, you can do social media, you can go to erotic fiction. I went to some comedy, she was hilarious. Then I went to something else. And I mean, it was absolutely exhausting because you're talking and you're listening and you're taking notes and then you're talking again.
Yeah.
But it was fantastic. And I went and pitched, you dart in and out. You've got to be on the ball, you're pitching places early on because they do
disappear. Yeah.
But we are, as we're standing in the line, there's people like, like, mate, it's just a chat. Don't worry. Yeah. You know, but you get to talk to.
I know, it is very nerve-wracking. I still get nervous. I'm pitching again.
Are you?
Because even though you kind of think once you've sold that you won't need to pitch, but I'm actually looking for an American agent, so I'm hoping to expand the market a little bit. So, and I haven't worried about it too much, but I know when I get there, I'll be shaking in my shoes, and when I'm in the line, you can't help it. I get.
Well, that's one of those things, though. Once you're in the middle of the pitch, then you relax.
It's exactly my first pitch. I was nearly having a panic attack, and I'm usually pretty cool, calm, and collected. But when I went in to meet the publisher, as soon as I shook hands, my whole body relaxed. I went, okay, I'm okay now. And then we just sat down and had a lovely chat. But the experience is different for everybody.
It is a great opportunity for unpublished authors, and I don't, of any genre, because you have, even though they're there looking for romance manuscripts, we have this year people from Pam Macmillan, people from Hachette, Penguin, Harlequin. Yep. And these are all mainstream publishers that publish other things other than romance.
But that's the thing about romance. I mean, it is contemporary women's fiction. It just has a theme of romance, which is anything. You know, romance that works, romance that doesn't, romance unrequited, romance required. You know, all those things.
The canon for romance is part of the thing that defines romance is that at the end it's a happy for now or a happy after. Right. So if you had a relationship that broke up and they went their separate ways, that would not be construed as romance. Because there's that reader expectation. It's like if you go to a Chinese restaurant and you order a meal and someone brings out, you know, Italian, you go, well, dude, that wasn't what I ordered. So it's a bit the same with romance. So because I'm unusually, most writers are quite eclectic in what they read.
Yeah.
I pretty much just read romance. I just read within my genre normally. Yeah. So my covenant with the author is I'm going to buy your book. I'm going to spend 5 or 6 hours reading it.
You haven't got the words to put on the page. When you're sitting there looking at that blank page, you've just got to keep going. And so that's what this song represents to me.
Beautiful. Well, let's have a listen and we'll come back and hear all about what Gordon was going to ask. Just like a wife, I cut him off.
Coming apart and out. Would you like to know more about how sport is played overseas? Phone Southern Cross Cultural Exchange now and ask for a German, French, Swedish or Finnish high school exchange student, boy or girl, to join your team or club, be it tennis, soccer, handball, basketball, skiing or skating. Share your life and sport from mid-August. Call 1800 500 501 or go to scce.com.au. Proud sponsors of 88.9 Win FM.
And we're back with some very chatty people.
We did warn you.
On Book Stage and Screen. Beautiful. We're back with Delwyn Jenkins and Lisa Edwards. Ireland. Why did I say Edwards? Nikki Edwards, who is joining you on the panel.
She is.
Mm. With Ali Blair. Beautiful. Mm. So we'll just mention again the Heroes and Happy Endings panel is at the Warren Ponds Library this Sunday from 3 p.m. Yeah. If you go to both Lisa Ireland's and Delwyn Jenkins' Facebook page, you'll be able to find the link.
Sure.
I mean, you can turn up, but it's best to always book these things. You don't want to get there and have the door person go, sorry, not you. You didn't book.
Yeah, we're hoping to get a good turnout, so it would be good to book pre-book.
Oh, it's so, you know, you pay at the Writers' Festival to see people like you talk about that. So this is free, people. Free! So head on down. Now, is there anything you'd like to, any projects you'd like to tell us about that you've got, or writing tips maybe that you want to share? Yeah,
here's my writing tip for the unwary. Finish the book. Seriously, the amount of last year at conference, I was looking after the newbies, so the people who'd come to conference for the first time, and the amount of people who, oh, I've just got the first three chapters, I've been working on them for 6 months. Oh, for the love of God, finish the book.
Just write.
The biggest tip I give people who are starting out, that first draft, you're just telling yourself, pinching someone else's quote, but you're just telling yourself the story. You can't really know what your first chapter is going to look like until you know how your book finishes.
Yeah.
So I can't tell you the amount of times that I've changed my first chapter after I finished my book. So that idea of front loading is rearranging deck chairs on the Titanic. Just get the book done.
Yeah.
I think one of the things that writers struggle with is finding time to write. Mm. I'm really good at this because I used to be a professional organiser before. So I've got the organising tips, and I think everyone's different. You have to find what works for you. But one of the great things to do is find someone to be accountable to. So I'm part of an online writers group. Yep. There's only five of us. We don't let anybody else in because when it gets too big, it gets unwieldy. So there's five of us. We turn up at the page every day and we are accountable to each other. We sprint online. So Facebook keeps, because it's a Facebook group, it keeps tagging our posts with sport because we have mentioned the word sprint all the time. but what the sprinting is, was we set the timer for, half an hour. We say we're starting at 11. The timer will go off at 11:30 and then we have to report back how many words. I've always written the least, but we're not racing each other. It's just about getting words on the page. So find an accountability partner.
Yeah, that's great advice.
What's a good number for you to, word-wise?
I try for 2,000 every day. Mm-hmm. I work five days a week, but that allows for days like today when I won't write anything today. So it doesn't average out. Like you'd think that I'd get 10,000 a week, but that never happens.
Good day for me is between 2 and 3. That's an average day. When I had that sort of Damocles deadline, a couple of days I wrote 6,000 and 8,000, but that's like killing myself.
My brain falls out.
Well, like after 4 or 5 hours, my brain falls out, and I've had enough. Rather look on Facebook.
We're done.
Well, thanks. They're great tips, and certainly work for you both. I mean, 11 books between you—that's amazing. So, well done. Congratulations. Enjoy the conference in Adelaide.
Thank you so much. Might have to get you back
to do a little bit of a, you know, what happened.
Oh, we would love
tips
to.
You can tell us about it.
When on conference, get blood all over where
Totally. That's okay. We've got your mouth.
Well, thanks again for joining us, and good luck to you.
Thank you.
Thanks.